Being blessed and highly favoured doesn't mean that we are socially, that we are understood. Trusting God to accomplish what he wants to set out relies on our willingness to serve him. And being an active member of God's household is more important than anything else.
The Christmas Story Part 2, Blessed and Highly Favoured, by Assistant Pastor Warren McNeil, is inspired by Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 56. Assistant Pastor Warren takes us through Mary's experience of a glorious baby announcement from an archangel, no less, and asks the question, what does our life look like when we are blessed and highly favoured by God?
Father, just thank you. Thank you for how this morning we've been led in reflecting in Jesus, your incarnation, and what that means. Lord, that for us that maybe have Christians for some years, that we sometimes do just take it as granted that God became flesh. Lord, I pray that some of us have been shaken from that apathy. And Lord, as we look at your word, as we look at a familiar story, Father, that one that we know well, we visit every year. But Lord, shake us from knowing it into really knowing it. In the name of Jesus, amen. Well, it's Christmas. I don't know if you noticed. Are you ready?
Yes.
Excellent. I'm so pleased. Well, we are... I'm going to try and trust the volume. As you may or may not know, Pastor David and I are actually sharing the teaching over the next few weeks, which is historic, something that's never been done before, so this should be interesting. So we're going to do that. It's going to be great. So I'm going to be sort of leaving off where Pastor David ended last week. Now, I wasn't here last week. I was preaching at another church. I was only here for the special members meeting. So I'm not quite sure what Pastor David actually spoke about. I'm hoping after a faithful 26 years of preaching correctly here that he's done the same last week as well. If I need to correct anything, I will. Only joking. But the story we're going to be looking at actually falls in between, in this parallel between the two passages that Pastor David took you through last week. And so we're going to look at that. And the theme, I think, for this week, the title is Blessed and Highly Favoured. Who feels blessed and highly favoured? Excellent. Cool. Now we're going to look at what that really means. Because it doesn't always look how we think it looks. I'm not going to go into names because it's nobody here, but I used to come across somebody who always, every time you greeted them, they say, yes, I'm blessed and how are you, was the good question. Blessed and highly favoured. I used to say it every time. So I then went, what does that mean for you one time? I decided to ask the question. His response was incredibly interesting. I'm not going to tell you whether it was right or wrong. It was interesting. So let's see what that looks like. So, who was here last week? I have to keep my arm down because I wasn't. So can you remember the three key things that you were meant to have learnt from last week? Somebody like to raise their hands? Can anybody remember? I know. No? Oh. Okay, shall I remind you? Do you remember the story you looked at? Okay, that's all right then. So Zachariah and Elizabeth, yes? Excellent. Okay. The three things you should have hopefully remembered are that God hears your prayers, even when he doesn't seem to. Is it all sort of clicking into place now? That's great. But in the meantime, you should continue serving him. God works on a long time scale. I mean, John's testimony alone goes to prove that God can work on a long time scale. And he planned to make it possible for all people to find forgiveness and reconciliation with him. Yes? We all know that as standard, and we all must be prepared. It's about preparation into Christmas. I believe that's what you learned. Excellent. So the story you looked at last week was Zachariah and Elizabeth. You will notice that they might have been a couple that were blessed in appearance, in high social standing, supposedly, Zachariah being a priest at the temple. And in the Bible, it says that they were blameless before God. They were living lives dedicated to God, but because Elizabeth's barrenness, there was a sense that they would have been almost falsely not liked or despised because it would have seen that she's not blessed by God because of her barrenness. I want to do a quick recap on that. But God answered that prayer, redeemed that situation, and Elizabeth almost was brought back into society by then being able to bear a child. You looked at those last week. She was back into being acceptable in the eyes of her peers. Not in the eyes of God, but in the eyes of society only. God already had her as acceptable prior to needing a child. And of course, this child came back by natural means, i.e. with her husband. I shall leave it at that. And God was concerned about a long-term salvation plan in that story. Quick recap. So we're going to look at a story that was happening within the same era, within the same time frame that slots in between the two passages. So are you ready? If you can turn with me to Luke chapter 1. Turn, find it on your phone, iPad, mobile. Luke chapter 1, verse 26. And I'll read for now to verse 29. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. Said, this is a story we all know, don't we? But there's always things to learn. Luke keeps us clearly within sort of the encounter with Zachariah and Elizabeth, keeps us in that time frame because the opening of in the sixth month. So that is clearly Elizabeth's 6 month. She was pregnant at this point by 6 months gone. So then Luke takes us out of really what was the center of social and cultural and political hub of the Israelites, Jerusalem and the temple, removes us from there, from this wonderful great city as such, and takes us north to an incredibly insignificant town in Nazareth. It was insignificant as a town. It wasn't particularly well respected. You'll see in one of the other Gospels later on in Jesus' ministry when they were talking about, look, we think this great guy, this great Messiah has come out, this prophet has come out of Nazareth. The quote is, Nazareth? Can anything good come out of Nazareth? To give you an idea. But Luke takes us there. We get taken really to a totally insignificant place. A place that we're not meant to hold with much regard. So in Luke's story, you get taken from Elizabeth and Zachariah, married, high-ranking status, to a virgin pledged to be wed in an insignificant town. So the stories, now I'm going to trip back to Elizabeth and Zachariah because we're going to need to occasionally because the stories have some parallel lessons for us to learn. So Gabriel turns up. It's Gabriel again. Archangel Gabriel turns up, holds the two places together, holds the two stories together. And he appears and claims that Mary is highly favored and the Lord is with her. Great words, eh? Imagine an angel turning up and saying, whoa, you're highly favored and the Lord is with you. That must be quite something, mustn't it? Just if you can take yourself back there for a minute, just that you're getting on with your daily duties, we'll come in a moment, but Mary would have been 12 or 13, getting on with the chores. Yes, she's about at some point going to be married not too far off into the future. You know, maybe only 5 or 6 or 7 months away, maybe. Yes? Sometime in May, maybe. I don't know. But she's getting on with her normal life. And an angel appears, Gabriel, and says, "You are highly favoured." Now, these should be words of comfort, shouldn't they? What wonderful words. Would you feel warm and fuzzy inside, saying, "Wow, I am blessed. I'm highly favoured. I have been encouraged. An angel has visited me." But we see in this that Mary is actually greatly troubled and wonders what it means. I will say this quickly on one sideline. I'm going to ask a question. Why do we think she was greatly troubled? But actually, when the angel came to her and said, greetings is not really, that's like sort of saying, "Hi, morning, how are you?" That sort of greet. It wasn't really. The NIV doesn't do it well. It's actually almost, he turned up and said, "Blessed! You are highly favoured." It's almost coming up and saying to somebody, "Hey, blessed," and give him a hug. Do you understand that? So, can understand. So why do we think she was greatly troubled? Because these are encouraging words. This is a real question. Oh, hang on. Need the microphone, Ben.
I would have thought she'd be fairly troubled just by an angel appearing out of nowhere.
Okay. She's been told she's blessed.
It's not always good news in the Old Testament when God says, "You've got my attention."
We're going to come back to that. Thank you. So we've come to this conclusion. Yep.
I think to be called blessed, I'd be saying, what, little old me? No, not little old me, you know.
Yeah.
How can someone from Nazareth be blessed?
Yeah. Yeah.
No. Just sort of troubled. I say, "What have I done now?"
What have I done now? Excellent. Some of you, all of you are right in one, it's all dependent, but you've got to understand, let's understand Mary's thinking. You're right, Nazareth, insignificant town, nothing good can come from there. So if you're an inhabitant and a citizen of Nazareth, you do know that you are within the wider scale of the Israelites, classed as socially low. Haven't got a great reputation for some reason. So for Mary, who's only pledged to be married at the moment, she's not of any high standing. She's almost socially low class. And we do see in this story, I just want us to try and see Mary's way of thinking, if it's possible. Some of this is just imagination, because we don't really know what's thinking. But we can see some stuff in here from what Luke has written. Firstly, she's pledged to be married. Now, let's explain being pledged to be married. In their time, back here, being pledged to be married, being betrothed, means you are not married yet. You're not even engaged. You're somewhere in between. So it's more than being engaged. You know, we have engagements here, apparently. This was good you're here this morning, isn't it? I can pick on the two of you. You're engaged, but you're actually a lot more than that. It is literally a pledge. It's going to happen no matter what. There's been exchange of the families have met. There's been exchange maybe of some financial transaction. And it's clear that they are going to be married. We all know this. And we all should know by now, because we've heard it plenty of times, that Mary was probably no more than 12 or 13. Joseph wouldn't have been that much older, but he would have been slightly older. And she's marrying this man. Mary is still living under her family household roof until the time that she's eventually married, which could take up to a year or up to 5 months, sometime in May, maybe. Just to point this out on the cameras, I don't believe that was the date they got married. It's an in-joke in here. But she is marrying Joseph, a man who is a descendant of King David, the great King David, the absolute Davidic, the king that everybody holds in high esteem within the Israelite nation. So he is of, Joseph himself is of real lineage, though still living in Nazareth. Mary, Luke doesn't even mention her family at all. Which the assumption from that, if they're not mentioned, they're not worth speaking of. They don't come from any great heritage or lineage. They're not worth talking about. So Mary really is, in the eyes of her nation, in the eyes of her community, low. Not worth talking about in those respects. And she hasn't gained Joseph's title, because once she marries Joseph, she's actually gained his title, his heritage, his Davidic line. Do you understand? She links into that family, and I know from some of you that come from cultures that get that straight away. That, yes, you inherit that family's line and heritage and social status. Joy married me, she just got my surname. And what? Anyway, moving on, Andy. More like the other one, no. So you can imagine that for Mary, she is not classed as high in status. So she has not sustained all of that. So actually, in the way that we talk about self-image, she may not have thought very much of herself. So to have the archangel, not just any old angel, but the archangel turn up and say, the Lord is with you, you are highly favoured. Whoa, as somebody said, who, me? But I'm a nobody. But that's what God does. He takes the lonely, he takes the poor, in whatever status you class that as, and says, yeah, I mean you. I am with you. I don't care what you think about yourself. I am with you. I don't worry about your self-image. Worry about the image that I have of you. You. So we can understand some of Mary's great trouble. But we'll continue with the story. See if she's got justified to continue to be troubled, shall we? Verse 30. But the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son. And you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end. Standard greeting of an angel. Do not be afraid. If you notice in all the Bibles, it always, do not be afraid. So clearly, there is fear in meeting an angel. Not all the time. Angels come in many guises. But in this particular case, I get a feeling that he turned up in all the glorious look. So there was no mistaking it was an angel. As quite rightly was said earlier on, my Marcy, I think that, don't know about you, but because of the Bible, we now know that if an angel appears, especially Gabriel, and says, do not be afraid, it's a time to concern yourself. Time to concern yourself because your life is just about to be radically changed. Mary maybe was slightly blissfully ignorant of what might be happening because she had such a low self-image. But if she thinks of somebody like Gideon, who was cowering away in the bottom of a pit, and the angel says, mighty warrior! You know your life is going to radically change at that point. Your status is definitely going to take a complete and utter lift to somewhere else that you did not expect. So if you get an angel tonight, do be slightly concerned. What you thought the plans were you had for tomorrow might well be radically changed today. But actually, following Jesus is just like that anyway. At any moment, Jesus can say, and shift your lifestyle. Shall we look at what it was? I just want to look at just what Gabriel just said to her and see if we can try and unpack some of that. So will you follow me with this? So he says, do not be afraid. You have found favor with God. Amen. You found favor with God. Excellent. Great. I found favor with God. Okay, still panicking. You will be with child. If you're a man, that's said to you, worry. But for Mary in her day, to be told that you will be with child, knowing that she is pledged to be married, for her culturally, to actually bring a child, for her culturally, hear this carefully, back in her time, and I know that still exists for us, some people today in some of their cultures, but for her to bring in a child is a great and amazing blessing that she can bring to her family and to her husband. Not saying that's right, I'm just saying culturally within her, that is what is seen to be done. So she's actually been promised, you have a child. Bearing in mind, if we look at parallel with Elizabeth, was barren and despised. So for Mary to hear that she will have a child, wow, that means I'm highly favored. And then to cap it all, says, and you're going to give birth to a son. Your first child is going to be male. Means your husband's going to have a male heir. Whoa. Big time for her time, big blessing. This must mean that God has really, really blessed me. Can you get your heads around that? That is just the big thing for her. So she's hearing good news. Really good news for her and for her future husband and therefore then for her family, for them within their own community. That's going to be just wow. And then you are to give him the name Jesus. So it's not that you've got to make up the name. God's actually giving you the name to give to him, which means the Lord is salvation. The Lord is salvation. Can you just get into Mary's head just for a moment? Just think, this must be just, getting all these, and I wouldn't mind, but the announcements actually come from an angel. Not mobile telephone. I haven't had to wait 9 months. I'm going to know this now in advance. Then the angel seems to really go on then to talk about this son who's going to be more than she expects. He will be great. Sorry? He'll be great? Now at this point she must be maybe thinking, possibly, that she's going to marry somebody in the line of King David. The Israelites are waiting for what they think is the Messiah Davidic king who's going to kick out the current Romans and hopefully rule properly. That could be going through her mind, you never know. He will be great. So it continues. He will be great and be called the Son of the Most High. And to be honest, Mary would not have had a clue what that meant. We know now, but back then, that did not mean what we think it means today. It would have had an understanding to do with being kingship and leadership or somebody who is attached to God, but not the way that we understand as a Messiah, as somebody who's going to die on the cross, somebody who's going to be Lord over all. Do you understand? Does not have the same. And we see that later on in the story when Jesus is doing his ministry. She still, Mary hasn't understood who her son is really about. She didn't quite understand that. But the Lord God will give him the throne of his father, David. He's going to be a king. But I'm some 12, 13-year-old in this lonely town called Nazareth that nothing good comes out of. How is that possible? Do you get the excitement? It doesn't make sense. I'm only going to go through this in this way. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will never end. Wow. Big news. That's amazing. Let's put yourself in Mary's spot right now. Let's put yourself today, and God has come and said something to you of a nature that just blows your mind. It's not about you personally, but it's the future that's going to come. But you're going to be part of that future. Through you, your child is going to be prime minister of this country. For some, through you, not so, I'm trying to think of the biggest thing I can within this world. Through you, going to become president of America. Now, why is that more exciting than... Anyway, okay, I won't ask. I understand some people's political bent at that point. Right. But do you understand what I mean? But actually, it goes beyond that. He's going to do so much. He or she are going to do so much stuff for God's kingdom that it's just going to go on forever. It's going to have a long-term consequence. It's going to be amazing. Could you imagine that? Get yourself wrapped up into that. Imagine how Mary must have felt at this point. And this is the thing I just want to note, verse 33. When he says his kingdom will never end, it's eternal. We know that. It's an eternal reign. It's a universal reign. Because if it's eternal, it has to be universal as well. Mary wouldn't have had a clue, really. Wouldn't have understood fully what was being said to her. She's probably still recovering from the fact that an angel appeared. I know I would be. Just want to know, at this point, she knows nothing other than she's going to have this son who seems to be going to be some great, amazing figure of a man. At the moment, it all sounds wonderful, doesn't it? Yeah, there seems to be no radical change other than the fact that she's going to produce a son. Nothing seems to be falling outside of her knowledge of her cultural understanding, her social understanding. Nothing has changed yet, other than the fact that an angel's appeared. So she asked quite a simple question, really. How will this be? Mary asked the angel, verse 34. Since I am a virgin. A right and good question. She's probably thinking, okay, maybe I've got to wait until I'm married, have natural relations with my husband, and then I will conceive. Inside wedlock. Because for her understanding in her time, that is what you should do. Sex inside of wedlock, not outside of wedlock. There's rules about that for them in the Old Testament. And still, I'll be up front, we as Christians should be believing the same thing. Sex should remain. I know our culture says it's okay today, but actually, God does say something completely different. It's inside of wedlock only. Moving on. So she's asking the right question. Well, how's this going to happen? I'm a virgin. And her status is re-emphasized. She is pure. In the eyes of the law, in the eyes of her culture, she has done nothing wrong. Everything she is doing is straight down the line. So let's look at that. The angel's answer is, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she, who was said to be barren, is in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God. Amen? Amen. Nothing is impossible with God. I want to look at the parallel between Mary's question and Zachariah's question. Or, as some have put it, Mary's objection and Zachariah's objection to how these two promises can be fulfilled. So come back to the fact that Mary says, how's this going to happen? I'm a virgin. We go to verse 18, if you're able to briefly, when Zachariah is told that he will have a child, he said, how can I be sure of this? I'm an old man and my wife is well on in years. On the surface, they both look like quite natural objections, questions to have. I'm sure you've unpacked the fact that with Zachariah, it's quite understandable. He's old and advanced. His wife has clearly been barren for years as far as they're concerned. How's it going to happen? We've been trying for long enough. And then for Mary, you're going to have quite the natural reaction of, I haven't done it yet. I'm still a virgin. I've not had relations with a man. But then I want to look at Gabriel's response to them both. The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One is to be born, will be called the Son of God. Gabriel responds and explains how it's going to happen. But to Zechariah's response, and I know you've unpacked this really well last week, and I'm not going to nowhere near try and emulate that way of doing it. But the angel answered, I am Gabriel, I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you. And now that you will be silent. Two different responses to two what looks like legitimate questions. Can we look at the parallel? Why the two different responses from Gabriel? One was one of, I'll just tell you how it's going to happen. The other one was, I'm telling you who I am, and now because of that, you're now going to be silent. Do you know why there's two different responses from Gabriel? From two people who were questioning, how's this going to happen? Of the same God. I'll get me exercise before the Christmas dinner.
Zechariah was an old man, and he was a prominent man in the church. Mary was a young girl, so I would suppose that Gabriel is saying to him, you should know better. And because Mary is younger, he gives her a proper explanation.
Okay.
In Zechariah's response, there seems to be an element of disbelief. How can I be sure? Is it really true? Kind of questioning. Mary's response is actually a bit more kind of, how's it going to be? It has less of a kind of disbelief element in it. Oh, that's interesting. How's that going to come about? It's more sort of accepting, it appears to me.
Anybody else? I decided when Karin spoke that she actually had read my notes. Because I think there's a part for me that Zachariah was a priest. He knew what we class as the Old Testament. I feel that sense that he should have known better. For me, there is a sense that he should have known better. Mary wasn't a priest and would not have been educated within the scriptures, not the way the boys were, would have known the stories, their history, but may not have known its detail. And yes, Denzel, you're right, this could be the combination of the two, but I get a feeling that the response was different because Mary would not have known better, where Zechariah should have known a lot better. He knew the scriptures. He was a priest. He was daily reminded of the stories. I think he should have been known better. Where Mary, God was more gracious with because she didn't know better. And she was right. She was asking the right question. I'm a virgin. How's it going to happen? So what lesson can we learn from those two different responses and maybe possibly those reasons why there was a difference in Gabriel's response. You know, when you just have a moment, is that the angel's name? Gabriel's response. What lesson can we learn?
Nothing is impossible with God.
Thank you, Dorothy. You waited to went all the way back, didn't you, Carol?
Well, I think the angel's response sort of mirrors really what God is like. Just the scripture that says, you know, those who are in authority or you who claim to know, you know, you're going to be sort of, he'll deal more harshly with you than if you don't claim to know, you know, you're not saying you know it or whatever.
Okay. So what you're saying is, Carol, then, let me pick up from that then. Who else? Sorry. Oh.
Sometimes what we think we know can get in the way. Sometimes it's better to be just simple and just to trust in God, not what we think we know.
Okay, thank you. You're going to have to lean over.
Sometimes failure to exercise faith or lack of faith might have consequences. So in case of Zachariah, he was put silent. In case of Mary, because of her knowledge and where she's from, I think he was a little more lenient with her.
Thank you. Last one, John.
For me, it's about where you are on your journey, where you are in your journey of faith. That we all know that if you read a text one day, God will say one thing to you because of where you are at the time. And then 3 years later, you might read the same text and he says something completely different because you're in a different place. And Zachariah and Mary weren't in the same place. So therefore, the appropriate response was different.
Thank you. It says in the Bible, in the New Testament, that we who teach will be judged more harshly. I try and skip that verse occasionally. It makes life a lot easier. But actually, for me, if we all agree with 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, could you turn that with me, please, quickly, if you can? Just keep your finger in Luke, because we're going to literally flick straight back there. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God. You are a royal priesthood. That's talking to the church, us. We all believe that we, especially in this church and within the Baptist denomination, that there is a priesthood of all believers. If you're a Christian, you're in the royal priesthood. Whether you are standing up here as a pastor or not, you're a member of a church and you're a Christian, you are a priest. Do you understand? For me, it means that when it comes down to things of God, maybe the possible, the impossible, and how we react to God's calling, if you're a Christian, you should know better than somebody who's a non-Christian. John's right. It depends on where you are at your walk. You might have only become a Christian last week, or you might have been a Christian for the last 30 years. But where we're at depends upon our response. But as priests, and if you want to class yourself as a Christian, could you put your hand in the air? You're a priest. May not wear the long flowing robes, but you're a priest. And we should know better when God is calling us to do some stuff. Our responses should be better. We should not always object, and we most certainly shouldn't be objectionable, but we should know better. We sometimes wonder why people, what we class as people in the world, i.e. those that don't know Jesus yet, why they just can't see it. Why don't I understand the truth of Jesus? Or why don't I understand that what they're doing right now is the wrong thing? We can see it. We go, yeah, we can see it because our eyes have been opened. But there's other places our eyes are very firmly shut and we should know better. Zechariah should have known better, in my humble view. I should know better at times. I think it's a lesson that we need to learn from the difference in the response, where Mary was more like a child in a way of being. She humbly was just asking a question, and God, quite rightly, understood she's not at that stage yet. Let's teach her correctly through Gabriel. Verse 38. After she's heard this fantastic stuff, her response was, after all of that, no matter what, even though she may not have understood fully, "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be to me as you have said." The angel then left her. There is her immediate response. "I am the Lord's servant." Now, at which point you're going to say, okay, that's fine. Gabriel's just said she's pregnant. But understand this, she's pregnant now. She's just been told that the Lord will overshadow. It's the Lord that's going to make her pregnant. It's not that she's going to have sex, let's put it bluntly. She's not going to have sex. She's actually going to become pregnant via the Holy Spirit by God. That pulls her out of her social class. That pulls her out. She's going to be pregnant outside of wedlock. Elizabeth was pulled back in to the social setting by being pregnant. Elizabeth has just accepted from God to be pulled out of social understanding, to be an outcast within her own social network by saying yes. Big thing. She recognized that doing something for God was more important than worrying about her social standing. Don't believe she sat there and just accepted it casually and with a sense of this will be all right. I'm sure there was a million questions and a million sets of fears running through her mind at that point. Nonetheless, she says, "I am the Lord's servant. Be it to me as he wants." I'm going to read this from Green. The commentary that is really helpful in this series. In calling herself, talking about Mary, in calling herself the Lord's servant, she acknowledges her submission to God's purpose, but also her role in insisting that purpose. Moreover, she claims a place in God's household. Indeed, in her context, her words relativize and actually place in jeopardy, I practiced this, place in jeopardy her status in Joseph's household. For her partnership in the purpose of God transcends the claims of the family. I just want to take that whole quote because for me that was really important. Following God, saying yes to God and following him is saying, actually, I know that the Lord loves me and I need to do his will far outweighs anything of my cultural or family setting. Do you see? Now, for some of us that come from certain cultures, like for me, that sometimes doesn't have such a major impact in my day-to-day life. For others, like Mary, major impact. I mean, literally would have cast her out of the family, chucked her out and said, you're an outcast. You are no longer, you are cut off from this family. You're no longer part of this family. You do not belong to this family. Don't expect anything from this family. Get rid of it. And that happens for people today who decide to follow Jesus. They are literally cut off. So when they say, I'm going to follow the Lord and go for it wholeheartedly, they're outcast. That means everything. They have sacrificed literally everything they know. For some of us, when we say I'm going to follow the Lord, it doesn't really have that major an impact. It doesn't feel like that much of a sacrifice. But for Mary to do this, she realized that being part of God's household, being under God's protection, under God's roof, was more important than being under her father's roof. Even under Joseph's roof, her future husband, who, by the way, has got the Davidic lineage, what a fantastic heritage that is. But for her, her heritage was more important than if she was under God's household roof. It far outweighed what her family thought. That's sacrifice, and that is what we are called to do. When it says, take up your cross and follow me, it's sacrifice. And some of us might have to sacrifice a whole bunch of other areas that feel really painful. Not just leaving, you know, our family might still accept us being Christians, but there might be other areas of our life where we've had to sacrifice. But it's more important, surely, to be under God's household roof, which is eternal and indestructible. Yes? This is a lesson we can learn from Mary's response here. But guess what? She's still blessed and highly favoured. She's just accepted the fact she's going to become a social outcast. We know elsewhere in the story, we know how the story plays out. But let's imagine ourselves there at that moment. In the other gospel, you know, Joseph decides he's going to divorce her quietly, but actually angels appear, dream, don't do it, she's doing God's will, take her as to be your wife. Fantastic. But we know that story, that bit of the story pans out okay. But at this point, when Mary says, I'm the Lord's servant, she didn't have a clue that was going to happen. As far as she's concerned, she's lost everything. And gained Yahweh. But she's lost everything else. A lesson for us to learn. Sometimes we must accept and say yes, no matter what the consequences. And it's easy to say it standing here than sometimes to actually do it standing here. Okay, so talking to myself as well. But she is still blessed and highly favoured, but it doesn't mean that she's in the right social scale. It doesn't mean that it's all going to be hunky-dory from here on in when you are highly favoured by God, does it? It doesn't. On the surface, it doesn't look it like it. Elizabeth looked highly favoured. Everything should have been sorted. But until she became pregnant, she wasn't fully included. Mary's fully included. She's now just about to spend the rest of her life potentially being completely excluded. Yet both are equally blessed and highly favoured. We can't judge somebody's walk on the surface of what goes on sometimes in front of us. Somebody can be really rich and say, I'm a Christian. And we go, wow, that person's blessed and highly favoured. Look at them, they're high class. Look at that, they've got everything. God is blessing them all the time. Doesn't mean that's come from God. Somebody could have absolutely nothing. And we say, oh, well, God's not blessing them. They could be absolutely the most blessed and highly favoured person going by God. God is all over them. God is with them totally. We cannot judge by eyes. Equally, somebody who is really, really rich might also be highly favoured and loved by God. God allows them to remain rich. We can't judge that. And equally, on the other hand as well. We should learn not to judge by our eyes, but what God is doing. Because God normally does stuff that we just never understand. And here, for Mary, she didn't understand. But she said, I am the Lord's servant. Let's carry on. Now, sometimes when we hear from God, some people just launch and say, I've heard from God, and just launch off and do it without actually testing what has been said to them. Now, an angel appearing sometimes might say, well, that's a good justification just to get on with it. But even Satan's demons are fallen angels, and they can masquerade as angels of light. So you always have to test everything. So here we have now, moving on to verse 39 to 45, this story. At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea. When she entered Zachariah's home and greeted Elizabeth, when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leapt for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that the Lord has said to her will be accomplished. Mary's not been told by Gabriel to go running off to Elizabeth. All that Gabriel said was, actually, your relative is now pregnant. So maybe Mary's running off to go and see what was said to me. If I find Elizabeth pregnant, does that then mean that this is all going to be true? It's testing. I see this as a test. I see she was verifying what was being said. Elizabeth, it would not have been widely known at this point that she was pregnant because they go into seclusion for 5 months. So she'd only just come out of seclusion. So maybe the news had not reached. So we have Mary turning up to visit her relative. Just as a sideline, by the way, if you'd never noticed that John the Baptist and Jesus were actually relatives. Just sometimes some of us don't notice that. It just skips past occasionally, but I just thought I'd mention it in passing. I just want to know really short out of this, because there's so much we could unpack. But actually, this is to do with being blessed and highly favoured in the eyes of our society. Firstly, and most obvious, that John the Baptist, the baby, growing still inside his mother's womb, and his mother are both filled with the Holy Spirit and recognise that in Mary, there is someone special. If the fact that it was Mary's voice that spoke, and it was the baby that leapt inside Elizabeth's womb, recognizing something very special about the baby that was inside Mary. And both, therefore, then the baby and Elizabeth were given godly insight into who Mary's baby was. They were filled with the Spirit. Elizabeth just clearly had the Holy Spirit pour out on her and had no option but to say all these amazing things. And I like this in verse 32. She said it in a loud voice. I would appreciate that. It goes to prove that loud voices do exist in the Bible. And she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear." And she goes on and on. But actually, what's interesting for me is the social conventions were thrown out the window again. Mary was the younger. So when she turned up to Elizabeth's household, she should have been honoured and blessed to be at Elizabeth's house. She should have deferenced herself towards Elizabeth. That's what Mary should have done. But what we have here is the older recognises the younger. And it actually is deference to the younger. Social conventions chucked out the window. All social class, social way of being got thrown out by God because Elizabeth says, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear." And then Elizabeth responds, "Why am I favoured that the mother of my Lord should come to me? Why am I favoured?" So Elizabeth classed herself, even though what it should have been, Mary should have said, "I am favoured to be in your household, my older relative Elizabeth." She wasn't. Elizabeth was going, "I am blessed. I am favoured because you have come to me." Now, I believe in respecting our elders, you'll be pleased to know. My mum is in the house. But I also believe that when we should respect our elders, it's as long as they're following the Lord's will. We have a right to speak out if we don't think they are in love, but we have a right maybe not to follow them if it's not them following Jesus. Do you understand? It does say, honour your mother and father, and we see that through the Bible. Respecting the elders, have so much to learn. But sometimes maybe for us, it's to the point that we respect and we forget that sometimes we might need to, in love, challenge if they're doing something wrong. Not that anything was wrong here, but Elizabeth clearly realised that she needs to be deference to Mary because of the baby that she is carrying. She needs to recognise that the Lord has really blessed her younger relative. and done something amazing through her. So she needs to feel favoured, that the Lord. And note this, that through the Holy Spirit, Elizabeth recognised it was her Lord that was inside Mary's womb. This unborn baby was her Lord. We now know that he is Lord, amen? Sometimes we fail to recognise that in our lives. But Elizabeth recognised it even when he was unborn. And then we have Mary's song. 46 to 55. Known as the Magnificat. And I would sing it to you. But I believe that you are blessed and highly favoured. And I can't do that damage to your ears. I shall just read it and then pull out two very quick things. My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him. From generation to generation, he has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, even as he said to our fathers. Luke is showing by the Magnificat here that it's not just the journey and the story here, but there's some meaning behind it. Meaning behind what God is doing. And two things that were pulled out of this, two running motif in this hymn of praise, was that God is seen as the divine warrior who brings deliverance. At 51, he has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud. This is a divine warrior sorting things out. He is doing great things. Mary is recognizing that at long last, God, Yahweh, is coming to deliver his people. As Green puts it, this is a God who engages in battle on behalf of his people. Does it with a baby. That's different, isn't it? We believe in battle with weapons. God does it with a baby. Interesting. And the second thing is that God is a God of a merciful covenant. He lifts up the lonely. He remembers his covenant from way back to Abraham. Long-term plan. It is all recognized in this one hymn, in these short 9 verses. There's a lot. There's history here. And then it ends with Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home. Returned home, not married, and 3 months pregnant. Effectively becoming a social outcast. But she is still blessed and highly favoured. She's blessed and highly favoured. Now, I'm going to ask the question I asked at the beginning. Who here is blessed and highly favoured? Does it mean your life is going to look okay? No. But you're still blessed and highly favoured. So if you feel like your life does not look okay right now, that does not mean you are not blessed and highly favoured. For me, there were three things out of this. Being blessed and highly favoured doesn't mean that we are socially, that we are understood. Trusting God to accomplish what he wants to set out relies on our willingness to serve him. And being an active member of God's household is more important than anything else. Let's pray. Father, I pray for this Christmas. Pray for this whole period of time, wherever we are, whatever we are doing, Lord, that maybe we need to recognize that amongst the festivities, amongst what our culture says, amongst what our family says we should be like, we sometimes recognize that we may may look like social outcasts as we do something that you ask us to do. I pray for us going forward as we are finishing the preparations for Christmas, that Lord Heavenly Father, going forward now and into 2014, we say yes to you, no matter what the circumstances. In the name of Jesus, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.